Good afternoon and aloha kakou. My name is Ray Tsuchiyama. I'm the contributor along with Russell Liu to my left for Asia in Review. And we have an exciting 30 minutes on setting a spotlight on new trends in global tourism today. And we're going to start out with Russell kind of describing a recent conference held in Honolulu that may be the conference that people will look back decades from now as defining a change in what's happening in tourism and business investment for Hawaii, for the entire state of Hawaii. He has spent over 13 years in Beijing in law and teaching, and is an expert on what's happening in China. And we're going to just turn to Russell and say, what was this conference all about? Mm-hmm. What's the name and when it was? And tell us the sponsors and so forth. What was this HTA conference?
Well, aloha, Ray. Thank you very much. It was really an honor to be part of the Hawaii Tourism Conference this year. The conference set the pace for a vision that I think, like the book, The Tipping Point. We're going to look 5 years from now and then think back. That was a magic moment when everything changed. And I think this conference is a real change. It was a fantastic conference. I've been to many global conferences. We have over 2,000 attendees all over the world. And it was exciting, it was dynamic, a lot of vision, a lot of clarity.
So looking at this conference vis-a-vis the previous conferences, what was different this time? What was different in terms of the markets for tourism, for how Hawaii positions itself? What were some themes that you can tell the audience?
Well, you know, talk about themes, you know, it was interesting because the executive summit, which preceded the actual conference, was designed for government leaders. The governor was there to give the keynote address, as well as industry leaders. And I was fortunate to attend. I was very humbled by it. And it really set the theme, and it was very impressive. We had Steve Uzell, first of all. He's a National Geographic photographer, but he's been to Hawaii over 82 times. And what he did was his message. His whole presentation at the Executive Summit was showing pictures of open roads around the U.S. and the globe. And the message there was, we need to look at an open road because sometimes the open road allows us to focus. It gives us clarity. It gives us a purpose and ideas. And it gives us the solution to the problems we have. So that set the pace. Then we had Billy Beane, the general manager of Oakland A's. Now, he had a very interesting movie. And his theme, he's made famous because of the movie, The Money Ball with Brad Pitt. And basically, what the movie was about was the Oakland A's, they were a losing team in the NBL. They had the smallest budget to work with. And what he did was he said, well, people look at baseball players. They look at them 6'5". Okay, they run fast and they look good in uniform. That's what we want to think of baseball players. But it turned out what he did was they hired a geek, stats guy, who ran the stats and said it wasn't how they look. It wasn't the number of home runs. It was the guy who got on the base most. And that baseball player was usually 5'6", short, squatty guy, 160 pounds. And he was much more valuable than a 6'5" guy that looked great in uniform. And he said, take the emotion out, look at your numbers, and you can be more efficient. Wonderful message. Then we had Mark Dunkley, CEO of Hawaiian Airlines. And his message was prophetic. He said, yes, Japan's a great tourist market. They're going to continue. They've, in fact, increased the flights to Japan. But he said there's a seismic change, a big change. They see it, and it's no secret. It's the China outbound tourism. They're spending millions more on promotion. And they're going to open up flights possibly to cities that are not on the east coast of the east part of the country. Seismic change, and he showed the numbers, and it's going to be huge for the next 50 years. And we need to get into it now. We cannot wait for it to happen because competing destinations.
So from this macro view of this moment in time, and of course, tourism is so important to Hawaii. It's like 7% of the economy. we are very dependent on people coming here and enjoy the natural scenery and also do investments and create jobs and so forth. Now, I heard that you were on a panel discussion on China and tourism. Any takeaways from there?
Sure.
What were the kind of, if you go down and say, from a macro viewpoint, this is the things that people are talking about?
Good. That's an excellent question, Ray. And I was actually on four panels. And it was exciting because this is the first time the HTA has put China on all day. Which meant that you had an opportunity to hear all the experts. There are several important takeaway that I had. Okay, first of all, we need to understand that the Chinese are here already. A lot of people will think, okay, they're small in numbers, and that we're going to wait till the money comes. And until the money comes, then we'll do something. Wrong. Why? Takeaway number two, the Chinese are heavy into technology, and one of the big complaints that they had was lack of signage and lack of technology, lack of Wi-Fi. And why? Because, you know, living in China, you know, it's my experience also. I communicate daily with other lawyers, other friends in China through WeChat. And what WeChat is a over the internet communication. It's real time. So for example, in Asia, everything is done by word of mouth. So what happens if somebody has a bad trip here, immediately they'll WeChat, either leave a voice message, take a picture, send it off, or type it in.
And you have a very interesting point that we cannot ignore that although China has been behind in the economy and technology until recently, they're overwhelmingly users of mobile technology and devices for e-commerce, business, all kinds of things.
Yes.
Now, even more than Americans, maybe.
Yes, it's even more because it used to be the PC. Now the smartphone market is, and actually China's been ahead for 5 years. I've used WeChat for several years. They call it WeChat. Wei means hello in Chinese. Wei, Wei, Wei.
Yeah, Wei.
That's right, exactly. Ray, you know a lot about Chinese language. Yeah. But in the U.S., you can see it on your Apple platform. It's called WeChat.
Uh-huh.
They dropped the I out.
Right.
So it's used, it's real time. So, you know, the past, you know, if there was a complaint in the industry about what we did wrong, it would go back, the visitor would go back, and we'd have like 2 or 3 weeks to come back and say, let's do a campaign because we did something wrong, okay? But now it's all real time, so immediately they'll know.
So your points about addressing the Chinese consumer or, you know, be consumer-centric. We have to respond in terms of signage. We have to respond in terms of mobile technology, in Wi-Fi. What are those?
Well, especially signage. That was that was a big thing, not only for Hawaii, but generally outbound Chinese tourists, wherever they go, Europe, U.S., the big complaint was signage. And really, in the Asian culture, it's really a sign of respect because they are a big group. In 2015, 129 million travelers outbound spent over $200 billion. And that's going to increase this year. And it's estimated it's going to be close to $300-400 billion in a few years, money-wise. That's a lot of money. So if they come to an airport and they don't see signage, they see Korean and Japanese, then they feel slighted. And they'll take a picture of that, send it back to China, and say, we're not welcome here. And I think we need to take a look at a lesson. And I go back because I've been in Beijing for many years.
Right.
And 6-7 years ago, when I'm in my language Mandarin classes, I would meet these managers from ANA, All Nippon
right,
Air,
right.
and JAL.
Right.
And they were taking Chinese. So I'm asking, why are you taking Chinese? Well, for them, it was a requirement, especially middle management. They want to move up. They had to take 2 years of Mandarin.
Oh.
And they had to be a certain level speaking Mandarin. Right. Fast forward. You know, when I go to Tokyo all the time, stopping over, every airport, Haneda, or Narita, everything is not only Japanese, but Chinese. Mm-hmm. All the Japanese staff, they all speak Chinese, Mandarin. And it's ironic. And I go on the airport express bus. My favorite is actually Haneda.
Right,
they renovated recently.
Yeah.
There's Chinese tapes. There's Mandarin.
Right.
And tons of Chinese who travel there. And
right.
in my office in Beijing, all my secretaries are eager. They're right. planning their trip to Tokyo. And they're planning what they're going to buy, you know. So it's no secret that the research showed up at this conference that one of the top five destinations for the Chinese is actually Tokyo.
So this is a big learning for Hawaii to learn from Japan about China.
And I think, yes, we should learn because they did things right and they knew in advance. And, you know, maybe the geographic difference, the culture. But I think that we can't wait any longer. We need to move on it. The big mistake is if we take them, you know, it's sort of the American thing. When they come, I will invest. We can't do that because if they don't see it now, they'll tell the market and they'll just turn away and go back. Two important reasons is that from this conference, the experts said that the two important groups that are traveling are the little emperors.
Right.
They are between 25 and 40, that generation, and the silver-haired. And the silver-haired are the ones that have a lot of money. They come in here. Their language is not so good. So when they don't see any Chinese signs or they get a bad experience, they will tell their friends, and you've lost a market.
Now, let's go back a little bit, little emperors. Is this kind of coming out of the child policy generation you're talking about?
That's correct.
Yeah.
There are two sets. Yeah. There's the 1980s onwards and 1990s onwards. They're slightly different. The 1990s are probably much better in language. And so when they see no signage, they may say, okay, I like the place, I'll come back. Okay, the 80s, maybe their language is okay, but so those are the two one-child policy.
Right, the categories. We're
categories,
about.
That's
age,
right.
Age categories.
That's right.
Now, the silver category, like in Japan, are will be less skilled in language, but also eager to go out. This may be sometimes their first trip abroad for many of these people, and they've kind of tried out domestic trips, and now they have some money, and they're going abroad to Hawaii. And is there anything that you see Hawaii addressing or accommodating, kind of like different marketing styles or so forth for the silver market?
Sure. I see because, you know, first of all, I think language is important. And I think I was a young high school student working in Waikiki for Cebu years ago. And, you know, so we learned that to make people welcome, we would say Japanese word, konnichiwa, or something,
right,
arigato,
right?
For the Chinese, the same. But, you know, for many people, they can't distinguish the difference between Chinese and Japanese.
Right.
And I have a thing to tell you. All you have to say is one sentence first. Yeah. Where are you from?
Yeah, right.
If they're from Japan, then you say in Japanese.
Right.
If they're from China, you say ni hao.
So you're going back to the hotel industry and training.
Yes, that's right.
At the customer level. I mean, this is the point of sale or, you know, greetings or people, concierge, those people, and there are thousands of these people who are having direct interaction with tourists. And here you're saying these little things mean a lot.
That's right. And, okay. And the smile, and if you know the Chinese, say ni hao, you know, it goes a long way. It's the experience. And it was the same thing for the Japanese tourists. So we got to think that we got two markets. We're adding on to what we have. And we just need to add a vocabulary. Just a few more words. That's all we need. And a second thing for the Chinese, if you know of a lot of Chinese tourists coming in, our big competitor, we call long-haul destinations.
And if you can hold on to that thought about long-haul, we'll be back in a few minutes after this important break, and you're on ThinkTech today.
Aloha, everybody. My name is Mark Shklov. I'd like you to join me for my program, Law Across the Sea, on thinktechhawaii.com. Aloha.
Hello, my name is Crystal. Let me tell you, my talk show, I'm all about health. It's healthy to talk about sex. It's healthy to talk about things that people don't talk about. It's healthy to discuss things that you think are unhealthy because you need to talk about it. So I welcome you to watch Quok Talk and engage in some provocative discussions on things that do relate to healthy issues and have a well-balanced attitude in life. Join me.
Welcome to Asia in the Wheel. Looking forward to see you next month on October 13, Thursday at 11 o'clock.
Thank you very much for joining us on ThinkTech today. We are continuing a very scintillating, exciting conversation on the seismic change that is right around the corner for Hawaii's tourism market regarding China And we're going to go into the long-haul market right now, transportation, which is a key to tourism, because that's how people get here. And go ahead, what is this long-haul so
okay.
important?
Well, I think, you know, that term, I learned it through the conference. We're a long-haul destination. Long-haul means we take 8 hours, 11 hours to get here, direct flights. Short-haul for the Chinese has been like Thailand, Southeast Asia, 4 or 5 hour flight. Right. And the reason why we make the distinction is because we need to look at our competition. Where are the Chinese going for long-haul destinations? And there's a paradigm shift because many Chinese have been traveling, you know, we're talking over the last 10 years, okay? They've been going to short-haul. So they're ready to change experience. Okay. They're ready to try a long-haul right. destination. That includes, for example, Australia, and the big competitor we have, an island destination, is the Maldives.
Right.
And Maldives is incredible. They do so much volume of travelers that there are four flights from their four national carriers daily. They even open a Chinese embassy there. But we need to look at the lessons of what they did right.
So short haul is all about trips to Seoul, to Tokyo, and of course Hong Kong, which is right across
right.
the border. But as you pointed out, there's been historically over the last 10 years or even more, great numbers of Chinese tourists to Thailand, to Bangkok, mm-hmm. the easy access via mm-hmm. visas and so forth. Singapore is another. But destinations that require a few more hours will include Sydney, Melbourne, New Zealand. Mm-hmm. So they must be also thinking about responding to the needs mm-hmm. and interests and aligning themselves, infrastructure to Chinese tourists too. Mm-hmm. But you pointed out Japan is one model that we should look at mm-hmm. Very closely. Are there any place else that came up during the conference that says, wow, they're doing something that's unusual, exciting?
Well, I think the Chinese have been going the last couple of years to a place called Maldives. It's off the Indian Ocean. It's really a European enclave for the wealthy, and it's interesting because the hotels there, they put in hot pot kettles for the Chinese. Oh. And why
for
do they,
tea for tea
well not only tea
oh,
Ray,
yeah, yeah.
Why do they do that? Because you know, in Hawaii we have a lot of Japanese restaurants, so
right.
I think the diet, the cuisine is there, right. But for the Chinese, we don't have the type of food they think. And so they carry, I travel with Chinese, I know this thing called fang bing men. And what is instant noodles?
Right.
But it's not just like your udon noodles,
right,
or simple ramen. It's hot, spicy.
Right.
And so when they go to a new destination like Hawaii, they don't have the restaurant, so they're really hungry. Or they go to Maldives.
Right.
So they come back to the rooms, and they just to fill their stomach up, they have this hot noodles, okay? So, you know, Maldives made the mistake where one hotel pulled the hot kettle tea pots away from the rooms. They left in the rooms of the European visitors who didn't use them. And so there was an outcry on WeChat in China. I was there in China, and the industry message is, let's stop going to Maldives.
Oh.
Let's boycott them. Let's cancel our bookings. So it hurt, really, the Maldives.
So it's
industry.
A black eye for the Maldives.
That's right.
Which they did not understand the Chinese tourism culture.
That's right. And you came to the point because we had one speaker who actually was called by the King of Cambodia to personally advise him on Chinese tourism and outbound tourism. So we had her talk, and she gave a fantastic presentation on everything to know about the Chinese culturally. And that's very important. We always talk about culture, 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 but I think people don't understand the culture. And so we had somebody on and said, we've heard this presentation about culture many times, but I turned to that person, but wait a minute, you have. Well, what have you done about it then? The reason why it's being said is because nobody does anything about it to adjust to the market.
Mm.
And it's what you do with it that's important.
Right. Now, you came to culture, but of course, and I want to go back to about business investment in a short while. But before that, all these leaders came to the conference, right, from the business community, from research, from the governments, of course, and so forth. So how much is the work to be done by the state government? How much to be done by, like, the private sector, like the Hawaiian Chamber of Commerce and the airlines and the hotels? Should it be a coalition? Who takes the lead and say, we have to organize and do this on a grand scale and make Waikiki a Chinese destination? What are the steps necessary to do that?
That's a great leading question. Well, I talked to somebody, the head of the Waikiki, I think the association, and I told him the language is important.
Right.
Start start educating people to look at them and don't assume that they're going to be Japanese. Right. So ask them, where are they from?
Right.
And then you can say the appropriate greeting. I think the other issue is signage. And I think that, I think it's a sign of respect. If you have Japanese signs, then have Chinese signs. Mm-hmm. You know, make everybody feel welcome. But you know, the telling sign is, you know, we just, 2 weeks ago, just when the conference began, we had some really important breaking news. And the news was this: China Oceanwide has announced they're gonna build a second resort besides their own hotel, right on the beach next to the Disney Hotel. They just finished acquiring the property to bring in the first Atlantis in the United States. And if you Google that, Atlantis in Dubai, you will see this magnificent 21st century hotel.
So it's a mega international hotel. Kind of thing. It dwarfs, you know, a lot of these smaller projects. So we're going to make a great leap, and this is what, going back to your seismic leap, this is not only a seismic leap in terms of tourists, but also in terms of project size. Right?
That's right. And to me, it's really shaping that we're here. This is the next level of tourism. It's global destination. Not just a destination, but a global destination. We should be proud, and we should welcome this kind of investment, and we should ramp up for this, because it helps us to bring in other good investments, possibly, that can change our look here, and not only have one kind of tourism, but a global tourism platform that's going to be something greater, and make us truly global. And I think that's very important, and I think that's not only a statement, the confidence that the high-wealth Chinese are going to be here because they're used to that kind of luxurious hotel, but also other travelers from Europe, from other places where they're accustomed to very high-end.
So just because the Chinese are coming here doesn't mean you continue business as usual. The Chinese themselves, through investment, are going to bring the bar and level up of tourism in Hawaii. That's what you're
trying
to say.
That's right. I'm saying let them invest in here what the Japanese did in the 80s, 90s,
yes.
And let's all benefit from it.
So the infrastructure even grows up because of this. So, but getting back to my question, there's the state government. There's where is, well, for example, you talk about language and culture. Where does that reside in Hawaii? University of Hawaii, mm-hmm. For Chinese language, the high schools, DOE, we had a previous show on immersion. There seems to be pieces of the puzzle that has to be put together. Hawaiian Airlines, of course, has a stake in opening up new cities to fly into. But when they come here, if there's not that, the welcome, mm-hmm. in the culturally sensitive areas, then it's not going to work, and we're going to have another Maldives black eye.
Yeah.
And that's what I think you're very frightened about for the future. Am I correct?
Yes,
or are you optimistic?
I'm optimistic, and I think that not just Hawaii, but overall, I think Americans, we have a tendency to short-term look. When the money comes, we'll move on it. But I think the second thing is, I think historically, Hawaii hasn't had a lot of culture ties with this new China.
Mm.
When I say new
right.
China,
right.
mainland China, oh, post-49,
right.
50s,
right.
You know, I can count the numbers on my hand of people that really have relationships or have really been in China. I think you need to listen to them, and you need to listen carefully, and you need to work with them to give you the relationships. Very important. Now's the time to do it. I think it starts from the governor. But I think I really applaud the Hawaii Tourism Association,
okay.
George Segetti. He's a businessman. And
he gets it.
Okay. And thank you to George and Randy Baltimore and J.D. Gu of the China side. They get it. They know where it's going to go.
In the hotel sector.
So he's leading that branding hotels. So that's why this conference was electrifying. It was dynamic. And I've been to many global conferences. There was excitement there, clearly excitement. And I think that we now have to work with the industries, and we need to get the government, the leadership, to say, okay, remember one thing. Tourism is the biggest driver. And Mark Dunkley, in his speech at the Executive Summit, clearly pointed out, federal spending's down. Military spending's
right.
going to go down. What do we have? So we need to work quickly. We need to move on it. And in this executive summit, Nainoa Thompson gave a very emotional, just a chicken skin presentation. He talked about Hokulea. He talked about the old going around the world, his message that we have to change, you know, how we think, you know, preserve the ocean. That word change and commitment. We need change and commitment, but it really starts from the leadership, you know. But I think it's something daring. There's a risk to take, but we have to do it.
Now, the Maldives, I've never been there, but like you said, it was mostly European destination and full of natural beauty. There's not much shopping going on there. Well, and I felt, wow, it's like going to Lanai or Molokai for some people, except they're very high-end luxury yes. resorts there. Is there a lesson in this? Can these destinations like Maldives and Kauai or Kona be attractive to Chinese tourists?
Well, that's a very good question. You know, you hit it on the point. We had a China Business Development Track. A speaker came from C-Trips. C-Trips is the largest online tour operator in China. It has 250 million members, and they book their travel around the world. And he said a prophetic message that says, Hawaii needs to differentiate itself from Maldives. Maldives has the sun, right. ocean, beaches, same as Hawaii.
Right.
So what does Hawaii have that's different? Well, we have shopping centers.
Right.
We have
right. yeah.
the dollar.
Right.
We have
right.
We have a different kind of culture.
Right.
We have sophistication, you know, fine dining.
Right.
It's a U.S. city.
Right.
All of these things all means there's an added value.
Right. Okay?
And one thing that he was amazed to me, he was saying, Russell, he said, you know what? I was amazed. You got some stores here that open 24 hours,
right.
and some that open at midnight. Other
right.
places close early.
Oh, good
so,
point.
So
okay.
it's a
point in our favor.
And that's a big point in the favor
right.
because again, there's an added value to it. But
right.
again, it's the thing that we need to do is we need to make them feel welcome.
Mm-hmm.
We need to feel them made welcome. That not only you know we have Japanese tourists, but we have now Chinese tourists, and that's why the Chinese are investing on the Kualina side because maybe Waikiki has not been so much. Interesting to them, it's a little older, needs improvement, and maybe, you know, they don't feel welcome in the Waikiki area. And I think it would be...
So you're talking about a Chinese investment to make a second Waikiki? That's a little grade up?
Well, possibly,
yeah,
you know, because
that,
it takes
yeah.
it takes a big overhaul in Waikiki.
That's right, that's right.
But, you know, it's good for them,
yeah.
it's good for Hawaii. And, you know, outer islands too. So I see it as a growing dynamic industry, but we need to quickly get on the curve. We need to get on this learning curve. We need to understand it. We need to learn culture. We need to make the fine-tuning changes that will make them welcome. First of all, the airport. Where are the signs in Chinese? Where's the language? Look in Tokyo Airport, all the language, all the signage is there. Even the airport bus that goes into the city,
right.
it's in Mandarin, they have Mandarin tapes. Again, these are things. And you know, remember saying the first and last impression a visitor gets to the airport. And one complaint I heard two of our presenters talk about is when they caught the taxi drivers were asking, that's not enough for a tip. How much are you giving for a tip? And that's a black eye. Because they're not accustomed to that.
Right, right. Well,
know, so.
Again, education, going back to education, even for taxi drivers, people who greet the people at the airport, signage, language, cultural sensitivity, the hot water at the hotel rooms. There's a whole list that goes on, and I think we have enough to go for another show, but at this point, unfortunately, we're out of time. And Russell, great to hear of your comments on the recent HTA conference. I think it is a seismic moment, but in order to move forward for Hawaii, we have to seize the moment. We thank you very much for Asian Review for ThinkTech. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Aloha.